Welcome to Downtown Alive, the show brought to you by the Downtown Improvement District of our great city of Reading. Today, I'm Cindy Kauffman. I'm filling in for our normal host that she's out a little sick today. So I'm here with the executive director from DID, Chuck Broad. Chuck and I, we've known each other a long time.
Yeah, I don't want to say how long. I don't want to say how long.
So this is kind of fun. This is a rare opportunity for us to host the TV show here. One of the things that we hope that we can accomplish today is introduce you to not only the DID and some of the services and wonderful people that are involved with that organization, but also some of the great things in our beloved town. There's a lot of hidden treasures that we hope that you'll find along with the some of the great people that are also involved downtown. And the first thing is I'm going to pass this to Chuck, and we're going to do a little segment that we've been starting to do in the last few months, and it's called Did You Know? And if you know these things, great. You're the kind of people we want to keep hearing from. But if you don't, we hope that you will learn something about our DID.
One of the core missions of the Improvement District is to keep downtown Reading clean and safe. And so tonight I wanted to talk just a little bit about some of our clean activities and things that you may not realize that we do. We do sidewalk cleaning both with pan and brooms and mechanical cleaning and powerful sidewalk vacuum cleaners. In all of last year, I want to share some stats with you on the number of trash bags we collected off the streets downtown. 44-gallon trash bags, we collected 35,004 44-gallon trash bags off the streets and curb lines of downtown. And that stretches all the way from down at Rack up to City Park and roughly from Chestnut Street out to, in some cases, Elm Street. So that's a lot of work. That's a lot of manual cleaning of the sidewalks. And it would be very noticeable if our guys weren't out there every day making sure that that material was picked up off the streets. I often tell people, if you want to have any indication of what it would be like if we weren't around doing those things, is take them to the edge of the district and look what it looks like across the street from where we're working, and you can see a major difference. The other thing that you may not realize is that every fall when we admire those wonderful colors on their trees, eventually at some point all those leaves fall to the ground and they have to be picked up by somebody, and that happens to be our ambassadors that are out there. And last year we collected 3,989, again, 44-gallon bags of leaves off the streets of downtown to make sure that they aren't there and have any slip hazards for people as they walk downtown. And we're also proud of the fact that we don't throw those leaves away. Those leaves are all taken to a mulch facility and are put back into the environment in a healthy way. We obviously empty them from those plastic trash bags that they're collected, but all those leaves are mulched and are used again in a favorable way in the downtown.
That's an amazing amount of trash bags.
It is.
I every time I hear that figure, it's hard to believe. Yeah. I guess one of the big things you guys have to be glad is over is the removal of the snow.
Oh, this winter was downright brutal for everybody in the community, but especially for our guys. And sometimes, you know, we don't have our hours on a Sunday, so if we had any snowfall over the weekend, on a Sunday especially, it's there until you get in the morning on Monday. And this winter was unusual for all of us that we had snow, and if you didn't get that snow up, you had more snow, and if you didn't get it up, there was more snow. So we ended up with a lot of compacted ice situations, and we actually have pickaxes that we were using downtown to chip ice off the sidewalks and the curb lines. And our guys were regularly breaking the wooden handles on the pickaxes trying to get that up. So it was brutal, not only with those conditions, but it was sub-zero temperature some days that they were working in. So it was brutal conditions and hard work, and I'm very, very proud of the effort that they put into clearing downtown. It obviously wasn't curbed from building line to curb line and totally clear, but we made pathways that people were able to maneuver
And you have a tough time with all the handicap ramps and everything that you have to deal with, keeping all those clear as well.
Yeah, technically we're not responsible for shoveling the sidewalks. The building owner is responsible for the sidewalks, but that doesn't always happen or doesn't happen quick enough, so we step in and do that. But we are responsible for the handicap ramps at the intersections and all the bus stops. So we make sure the bus stops are clear so buses can pull in and people can safely get on and off the buses to come downtown and to leave downtown for work or pleasure, whatever they're doing, or shopping.
That was a challenge this year.
It was a major challenge.
But we're past that. I think we're finally in the spring.
I'm hoping. We did put the snow plow on our four-wheel drive vehicle in the garage.
Yay.
So I'm hoping that this is an indication we'll never see it until next winter.
And maybe not as much.
Hopefully.
Well, the next thing that we really would like to go into is we were fortunate enough to get Jackie Hoffman to go down to the GoggleWorks, which is a wonderful art center here in downtown Reading that hopefully most of you are familiar with. They've done quite a wonderful job of restoring an old building into something that's really quite interesting to go in and see. It's got some interactive parts of it that makes it very unique. And they went down and taped. Did you have an idea? Did they say what we were going to be able to see?
Yeah, Jackie was down there with Martha Moore Westbrook and Tim Riley, and the video is going to show us how they carve a pendant and also how to alter designs and how to take it from a wax design into a wow design.
I understand they took a lot of video. It was hard to condense, so hopefully you'll get to follow along and see this and understand. If not, this is a good reason to have to go down to the GoggleWorks and visit it in person.
We're here at the GoggleWorks. I'm Jackie Hoffman, and we're going to learn a little bit about jewelry. We all love jewelry, men, women, no matter who you are, but we're going to learn how to make our own jewelry. So if you're interested in that, this is the place to be with two great folks who know the best about the business. We have Martha Moore Westbrook and Tim Riley. Thank you so much for joining us and being
Thank
a
you.
Part of our
Thank
special
you, yes.
show,
Thank
Downtown
you.
Alive. So you're going to tell us about some classes that are on the way and how people can find out more about it.
Definitely. Yes, at the GoggleWorks Center for the Arts in Reading, PA, we are currently offering jewelry and metalsmithing classes. These are running right now on Saturdays in the beginner and the intermediate level, also on Wednesdays.
I want everyone to take a close look at all of this beautiful work here. Could a beginner learn how to make something just like that?
Absolutely.
Oh, good.
Yes. I mean, we'll take a little bit of practice to be able to make certain things, but definitely. In fact, one of the things that we were going to be demonstrating was how to make something like this, which is a GoggleWorks ring. This was made specifically to kind of launch these intensives. They come in different sizes. And they're actually carved by Tim Riley in wax. And we're going to talk about the lost wax carving and casting process and do a demonstration to that effect.
Yeah, I'd like to start with a little bit of a design that I came up with the other night that from a sketch. Basically what's done is do a rough sketch with your design and then trace it, and this will be a pendant. So it's traced and then attached to the wax, and with a needle you pierce the paper onto the wax. And some folks like to put baby powder to make the dots appear, but I've been doing this for a while and I don't need the dots anymore, so.
So you know what you're gonna carve.
Yeah, I don't need the powder any longer, and I'm just gonna go ahead and see how far I can get carving this with the time that we have today. Basically what I'm using here is a coping saw with a wax blade. And the material itself is pretty easy to work with. It's softer than wood and more flexible than wood. So the basic shape is there, and I'm going to try and get it a little tighter. Got its basic shape right now. I'm going to have to pierce it out and tighten up the design a little bit, but as you can see, that wasn't that hard. And just a matter of giving it a whirl, give it a try.
You better have a steady hand when you do that, right?
Well, it helps, and I think that a lot of the skill comes after just keep on trying, and it's not that difficult, and perhaps with a little courage or a little persistence, yeah, you can. Anybody can do this.
How long have you been doing this, by the way?
About 34 years in August, I think it was.
Because you do make it look very easy.
Oh, okay.
You really do.
You can see the before and the after the cast. For right now, I'm going to adapt these waxes to maybe change their appearance a little bit and have a little bit of fun with them and see if we can't change them.
You know, I think the really exciting thing to know for our viewers is the fact that you can do this at home, Martha. You had said that you can actually do the carving at home and learn more about the process of it and come to the classes and learn more and then obtain some of these tools that you might need for the future and just continue to do this on your own.
Sure. The things we want to emphasize in the workshop is what these materials are, where you can get them, and just explain it in a way that anybody can understand. It can be cast in any fine metal. So these could be in gold, they could be in silver. And then the casting houses will often finish for you as well and do the polishing so that you're actually designing and making the artistic part of the process but leaving the technical aspects to an actual company that specializes in that.
This one here, I tried to put a little bit of a 5 o'clock shadow on the bottom. It didn't turn out quite the way I would like, but you can see that. And the ladies' version has some eyebrows and I don't know. What do you think? I had a little fun doing it. We're using equipment that is going to be used in the process of going from wax to casting. What we have here is what they call a broken arm centrifugal casting machine, where the crucible holds the metal, and we're going to melt it, and we're going to introduce the flask to the arm and spin the metal into the flask. Into the cavity where the wax melted out of, making room for the molten metal. And this is where it goes kind of like the course says, from wax to wow. We're going to go from a wax carving to a casting.
Thus the safety glasses, mind you.
Let's see how long. Oh, it's going to melt pretty quick.
Ready.
Okay. This is a flask that's void of its wax. In other words, the wax has melted out in the oven for about 8 hours. Okay, at this point in time, we're going to release the spring and the metal's going to fly. So, this is an abbreviated version of the actual process, but this is what it looks like. When the flask is done spinning, we'll remove the flask from the arm and quench the flask into water. Usually this takes about 10 minutes. You don't want to do it right away or you could have explosive results. But we've speeded things up just for the camera here today. The molten metal's cooling off. And after a few minutes, it's ready to come out. And here you have a rough casting. Complete with its sprue base where the metal was introduced to the empty cavity and filled it up. And now you have a casting where the wax used to be. From wax to wow, huh?
Yeah.
Okay.
There's your GoggleWorks ring. Thank you, Martha and Tim, for doing a fine job and showing your wax to wow. I loved it. I learned a lot. Maybe go home with some more jewelry or the knowledge of how to make my own jewelry someday or learn how to do it here at the Goggle Works.
Wow, I learned a lot.
Yeah.
I'm ready to go down there and make some jewelry. How about you, Chuck?
I think so.
I think that if nothing else, what we learned about the jewelry was also all the cool things that happened down at the GoggleWorks. It is really an exciting place to be, and as you can see, some really talented folks. Wow.
And the GoggleWorks is also a building not just where these wonderful creative things happen, but it's also the home for many organizations that serve our community. One of those is the Berks Arts Council. And with us tonight representing the Berks Arts Council is Rosemary Frank-Vitale, who's going to bring us up to date on an event that they're having in the community called Def Jam. So I'll let that, I'll let you explain what Def Jam is.
Okay, well, it's spelled D-E-A-F Jam. It is a documentary, actually. We have had a film festival for probably about 10 years, and I think it was about 3 years ago, Def Jam won first place in the documentary category. It is an extraordinary film about American Sign Language slam poetry, which I don't know if you can even imagine what that is like, but I do have a little clip that I'm going to show you. Why I'm talking about this is that the Hidden River Film Institute, which is sort of the reincarnation of our film festival, renamed. Did we talk about that on this show?
Karen did last month.
Yeah,
yes.
Right. Mm-hmm. So we have the new Film Institute, which will eventually, we hope, incorporate another film festival. But in the meantime, we're having independent film nights every month. And this month, on April 17th at 7 o'clock at the IMAX, the RC Cinemas at 2nd and Washington and the IMAX, this is where we will have Def Jam. I'm going to show you a little clip of this because it's really an inspiring and wonderful story. It focuses on one young woman who is deaf and who is into American Sign Language poetry. And she eventually becomes affiliated with slam poetry. And these people, of course, are hearing. She actually forms an alliance with a young Palestinian girl. She herself is from Israel. So there's all sorts of layers of interest here about community and how we live our lives. At any rate, I'm going to show you this clip, and I'm sure you'll find it very interesting. And I'm hoping that you might be interested in coming out to see Def Jam next Wednesday. Now, just bear with me because I don't have actually the right type of computer for this, so I just have to set it up.
What do you love about being deaf, and what do you hate about it? Hearing people. Wow, they have lots of people to choose from. I'd like to hang out with more hearing people too, but communication is the key, and I can't do it with them. I love deafness. It's peaceful. Airplanes go by, I don't hear them. I struggle. I want to hear music. Stop saying can't, but I don't fit in. You can, but I can't speak and I can't sing in the future, ever. Will I?
So Saturday night is a big deal. It's the first time that deaf teens are going to be in the slams.
I am a growing awareness of history's mask.
I'm going to sign my poem in ASL in its purest form, without being voiced.
Well, thank you. I mean, it doesn't do justice to the film. It is an inspiring story. These are, there's a lot of young people who are involved in this, and it is a wonderful and amazing story, and I hope that that you come out.
It's an amazing story, and you would never think that those two worlds could come together.
Really, Chuck, you have to see it. It's so interesting. And because she's an Israeli girl,
yeah.
and it is just happenstance that they meet and have these similar interests, and they come from a part of the world that are traditional
enemies.
It's
like two cultures that aren't getting along usually.
Yes.
Yeah, it's an amazing story.
Yeah.
Well, thank you for bringing it to us through
pleasure.
Your film festival.
My
it's
pleasure.
A wonderful
Thanks
opportunity, and we're so glad that it's happening in downtown Reading for
yeah,
us.
Yeah, me too.
Thank you. Thanks for being with us.
Sure.
Is there a website that folks can go to?
Yes. Let me just... It's the Berks Arts Council, and it's berksarts.org.
That's great. I think, just to let BCTV know, we had another video that we were going to show for this show, but we've gotten so much into the show and so much collected, I think we're going to save it for next month. Just to give you a little maybe teaser about it,
right.
It's a little unknown business in the city of Reading that's been here a long time.
And it's one of those gems you talked about. It's
right.
really a jewel in downtown Reading, and we're eager to expose it.
And it's called the Iron Horse, and it's one of those things that if you've never been in, it's just an experience to go into
yeah,
the shop
absolutely.
And see it. So I think we'll take the time to, maybe we can get Mr. Iron Horse to come in to the show next month.
I think that will be the goal for next month. And I mean, if you grew up when we did, and your parents may have had a train layout in the house or at Christmas time as my parents did, and I loved doing that with them, the Iron Horse Hobby Shop on South 6th Street is a mecca for anybody who is interested in model trains like that. And so we'll look forward to having that video segment next month and bringing somebody, hopefully, from the shop onto the show to talk more in depth about
it. Our roving reporter, Liz McCauley, was there to get some great and a great interview, and we thank BCTV, Amber, who was down there videotaping it. They've been doing a great job of going out. Some of the things
that... I think the field segments have added greatly to the show.
Well, you can't get a sense of what the GoggleWorks is unless you see the building, and I think the Iron Horse is the same way.
Having somebody come on the show and just talk about something doesn't quite do service to what's actually happening in our downtown. So we're happy to have this opportunity to take you out into the downtown and show you things that are actually occurring as they occur, and to whet your appetite for things that you can do. Instead of sitting at home watching some show some night, you can go down to the GoggleWorks and make some jewelry or make some glass objects or participate in some painting lessons. So it's a wonderful location.
I think we want to encourage folks to also get involved with the social media that's available through the Downtown Improvement District. Go out on Facebook, like us, get to join in some of that kind of fun. The other thing is make sure you put on your calendar the upcoming midday cafes that are coming up the beginning of June and go through till September. You can go out on our website and start finding out information. We've got a great lineup of music this year. Some folks that maybe you haven't heard for quite a while. And of course, we always kick it off on a Friday with the World War II Museum's event. And it's a great time in downtown Reading. Well, it looks like we're out of time.
I think we're out of town.
And
thank you, Cindy, very much for pinch hitting tonight.
Oh, no problem. This is fun. We have a good time, and I think that it's important for folks to know what they have to be proud of in our downtown,
absolutely.
And the Downtown Improvement District is one of those things. So until next month, we'll see you.
Good night.